Well, welcome everybody. We're so glad you're here tonight. What an amazing turnout this is tonight. We knew when we threw together four pretty famous NFL players in one stage, we knew that we could get a pretty good turnout, but this is awesome. Just a quick introduction. I'm Bill Guttery. I'm the CEO of Charter One, the company that runs all of the ALA schools countrywide. And ALA now has, or Charter One now has, about 21,000 students all over the country. And so we're really proud of ALA and what they've done and what we've been able to build together. And it all comes from the families, really. When I think of ALA's success, I think of our incredible board of directors, of which we have several here tonight. I think of our incredible families that come out to stuff like this, that support their athletes, support the arts, support the academics. I just think of the amazing community we're in, of which these kids serve every day, that they're out there in the community and they're serving. I think of all the stories behind what ALA does every day. Having Veterans Days that are off the charts, having first responder nights at football fields with helicopters flying in, giving out the game ball, the Friday night lights that happen every weekend, and just incredible coaches. And so ALA has just built this amazing tradition of sports and of arts and of academics that is so strong. As I think about ALA, I think about the vision to learn, lead, and change the world. And really, tonight is one of those nights where we want to change the world, where we want to talk about wellness. We want to talk about athletes and being mentally strong and physically strong and staying that way. And so we brought in just a team of experts to be able to do that. I think everything that ALA does is focused around the family. Because we know the family unit is the center of society. The family unit is, if society's going to make it, it's going to be with the family. And so everything we do at Charter One, everything we do at ALA is to support the family and to give you the opportunity to have a resource in your education like ALA is for you. That when they come home, you don't have to retrain them. We're teaching them the same things, the same values that you're teaching them at home. And so we just feel like a partner with you. These are your kids, not ours. You're the parents, we're not. But we want to be a resource to you to help you to give your kids everything they need to be successful. And I know that's what you want, and that's what we want, and I know that partnership is so strong. So I'd like everybody to give yourself a big round of applause for being here tonight. Thank you. I want to make sure there isn't something else I wanted to say. Okay. So this team that we brought in is amazing. We partnered together with Forever Young Foundation forever, and we love Steve and what he does, and we participate in a lot of their events. Michelle is here from Forever Young Foundation. Sterling Tanner is here from Forever Young Foundation. We're so glad to have them here. And whatever Steve and Barbara are doing, we want to be involved with. And being able to be a part of this, A Mind for All Seasons, is that partnership that we really want to cultivate. And so the three items, the ALA, A Mind for All Seasons, and Forever Young Foundation, bring you this tonight. And we're excited to be able to have Randy Vaudry here, is going to be kind of our host and kind of lead everything. I'm going to turn the time over to Randy and let him introduce everybody and let him introduce the program and what we're going to do tonight and maybe some special cameos. So, Randy, it's all yours.
Bill, thank you so much. Thank you for being here tonight. We hope to make it well worth your while, and we hope that when you leave tonight, you leave with some pearls that will help you age gracefully and help protect these young students from any concussions or challenges that happen amid the bumps that we come across in life, okay? And before we get started tonight, we've got a special message from Steve Young. So I'm going to turn the time over to Steve Young here for just a second to give you a little love note for our evening tonight.
All right, welcome everybody. Steve Young here. I know you guys are meeting in the Student Wellness and Concussion Awareness event. What I love about this is that, first of all, you have a lot of my friends with you. Gary Plummer, Junior Bryant, Ty Detmer, Max Hall, some of them former BYU Cougars, former NFL teammates. But what you have is a group of people that can let you know, the most important thing I want you to know tonight is that so much of being a great athlete, so much of great accomplishments and goal setting and getting things, doing things is being a warrior, being tough-minded, being strong. And what I think what we want to say is, when it comes to head injury, when it comes to mental health, when it comes to the vulnerabilities of life, that you do not have to give up on being a warrior or to be a very, very strong-minded person, to ask vulnerable questions around the weaknesses that you may have. And I think these guys are here to tell you about theirs. I wish I had more time to tell you about mine, but I think having the vulnerability to recognize that you can be two things at once. You can be an ultimate warrior, yet have questions about mental health, have questions about your physical health and well-being, and that you can ask those and get the help that you need so that you can be an even greater warrior. And that's the idea for tonight. And so in that awareness, I appreciate what you're doing in Arizona. And to my friends, don't tell any stories to make fun of me, okay? I'm very easily made fun of, and so I don't want the five or six of you to start telling stories, and then we'd be there all night telling funny stories about what goofball Steve Young is, okay? Deal. Have fun, everybody.
What do you think? Wasn't that awesome? Okay, so here's our plan tonight. We're going to start with a message from Gary Plummer. Now, I'm going to tell you a quick story about my relationship with Gary. It actually started in 2018. And he knows this, but he may have forgotten this. In 2018, I'm studying brain health, and I'm trying to figure out what types of things can I do to help my patients age gracefully and avoid the ravages of concussions. And in Sports Illustrated 2018, there was this fantastic article about a football player getting his head straight. It was all about Gary Plummer. And I read this article, and it dawned on me, man, that guy is right on. He is spot on. I hope I get the opportunity to meet him someday. Then in August last year, I'm on my anniversary trip with my sweet wife. Where is she at? My sweet wife right here. She and I are in Tampa, Florida on vacation, and I get a text from my business partner that said, hey, Gary Plummer's willing to do a Zoom meeting. Are you available? And I said, sure am. Let's do it this afternoon. So I told my sweet wife, let's go back to the hotel where we got internet access. I get the opportunity to meet a rock star. I got the opportunity to have my first interview with Gary Plummer in August after reading that article 5 years earlier. He's going to tell you about some of his experiences that helped him exceed beyond the boundaries and get into the NFL. Gary, come up on stage. Time's yours.
Thank you, Randy. First of all, there's a few schools here. The Warriors are here, right? There's some guys from the school called the Warriors back here. I heard, right here too. Mission San Jose High School Warriors. It's only about 60 years ago, but. So I guess I'll start off with Ty Detmer had been talking about Steve earlier, and he said, does that guy comb his hair with a brick? And I was like, wow, really, Ty? It's just what we do with Steve, you know. But what I'd like to start with is this naysayer. How many people in here have been told, if you're an athlete, you're not big enough? Anybody? You're not strong enough. You're not fast enough. How about anyone else? You're not smart enough. To me, that's what had happened my entire life growing up. And I graduated from high school. I was 5'10", 180 pounds. And we won the state title, and yet I think 9 guys got scholarships, but I wasn't one of them. So I went to a JC. Did pretty well there, played both ways, and was starting to get recruited by Stanford. I was so excited about this opportunity to go to a school as good as Stanford. My parents didn't have any money, and I knew I'd have to get a scholarship. So this guy right here, he came to my junior college, and he had been telling me for, there was no internet back then, but he'd been calling me and telling me for months that I was the greatest thing since sliced bread. So I was super excited. I'm getting this scholarship to go to Stanford and play middle linebacker. This guy walked in to the coach's office. Now at this time, I bulked up. I'm 200 pounds now, not just 180, Ty. And he looks at me. He said, "You're Gary Plummer?" I kind of puffed out my chest, what little there was. And he laughed in my face and said, "You can't play in the Pac-10. It still, to this day, brings back emotions. It still makes me angry, disappointed, upset, and I quit. My junior college coach, I'm going to stay emotional here because he just passed a couple of years ago. He called me and left messages. "Gary, you are not quitting football. You're the best football player I've ever coached in my life. You're not going to quit." So I wouldn't answer his calls. 2 weeks later, he shows up at my door. He also happened to be the wrestling coach. So you didn't want to mess with this guy. And he put his finger in my face and said, "You will get back in school. You will wrestle for me this year. And you will continue playing football." So if it wasn't for Coach Mike Cowan, I never would have made it. But this guy right here, what happened after that for the next approximately 14 years, I saw his face laughing at me, telling me I wasn't good enough. And to me, that's a huge message for anyone in here. You can either accept what somebody says and prove them right, or you can just smile in their face and prove them wrong. To me, why would you give anyone else control of your destiny? Why? Doesn't make any sense to me. So this guy, excuse me, we'll go back to that slide. Sure, we'll move on to that. So that guy was my motivational factor for a long time. I end up playing in the USFL. If we can go back to that slide. I end up playing in the USFL for, we got something going on up there. The USFL picture was the Oakland Invaders against the Arizona Wranglers. I know it's the USFL again, but this was the original one in 1983. And I just realized the other day, because somebody had a Facebook post of a tackle that I was making 40 years ago. It was about 2 weeks ago. 40 years? That's absolutely insane to me that it's been that long. And the next picture that you guys had of the coach that is in an Oakland Raider uniform, coach, we'll get there, I promise. He was the old white guy. None of us do this on our own. That's another huge message. None of us do this thing called life on our own. You need these teachers. You need these administrators. You need these coaches, your parents, friends. We need to surround ourselves with good people. And this guy, this man right here, Mike Halachek, coached for about 38 years. He wasn't a yeller. He wasn't a screamer. If you didn't get it done right, he just said, "Do it again. You're in practice, do it again. This time, try and do it right." He would raise his voice about twice a season, and trust me, when he did, everybody listened. And I owe so much to him because prior to that game 40 years ago, I had walked on at the University of California at Berkeley because that's Stanford's rival, and I wanted to beat the heck out of Stanford. And some of you aren't old enough, or most of you aren't old enough to remember, it's called The Play, and it's where the guy ran through the band at the end of the game. That was my final game of my season, of my senior year. I went to school to become a primary grade school teacher. I thought that was the last game I'd ever play. But the USFL came along, and this guy was my coach. And I had played nose tackle. Remember, I was too small in high school? They moved me to nose tackle when I got to Cal at 228 pounds and said, let's see what you can do there. So, anyway, when I finally get to the NFL, the USFL, this guy is my coach. He says, you're going to start this week. And I told him I wasn't ready. And he took me into a classroom and sat me down and just went over game film for hours and made sure I was ready for that opening game. And I'll be forever indebted. I literally, when I saw the picture on Facebook, I called him and, you know, got really emotional. I just said, it's been 40 years. We still talk to each other every once in a while, still see each other every once in a while. But Coach Hack, I just want to tell you, I couldn't have done it without you. And to me, that's one of the things we always have to remember, is that these coaches are dedicated. They're spending their time helping you guys out. Your parents, it can be a brother, it can be a sister. For me, you have to look for inspiration, because early in my life, it was actually in those years that I was in the junior college, my brother had leukemia, and he had it for 2 years, and his treatments weren't working, so he tried something else. And what it was he just put on running shoes and he just went. So I think I was around 20 years old and he was 26 at the time. And we go running and we're at mile 10. I'm not a jogger. And I can't stop because here's my brother with leukemia dying and he's still going. We did 18 miles that day. That taught me something, that you can push yourself through anything. By the way, my brother has had 3 other cancers since. He's still alive because he just keeps fighting. But I used to think about that in training camp when you're with somebody like Junior Bryant and you're doing pass rush drills against 320-pound offensive linemen. There is nothing fun about that. And when you do it twice in the same day and you end up doing it for 30 straight days in training camp where it's over 100 degrees, there's nothing fun about it. And you want to quit. You're sore. You're tired. It feels like you just run through a gauntlet of people hitting you with baseball bats. But I would reflect back on my brother. So that was just that one nugget that I got from my brother that helped me many times. Because you just look for those things in your life. You look for the inspiration. And we'll move to... So this is something that I didn't know Thomas Edison had said it. I asked Randy. I use this all the time. I say most people don't recognize opportunity because it comes disguised as hard work. And I think we all have opportunities in our life. It's just, it might be too hard, so we don't try it. You're never going to get there if you don't try, if you don't take that first step. But it's also about, for me, actually, this is a good story, okay? Well, these are my two boys. We happen to be playing in this thing called the Super Bowl, and there was a guy next to me named Ricky Jackson, who was in his 13th year. That was my 12th season. We had just got there to the 49ers from different teams. And all of a sudden, a guy comes up and he leans in, puts his hand on my shoulder, puts his hand on Ricky Jackson's shoulder, and he said, "Don't worry, guys. Tonight I'm getting you your first Super Bowl ring." It was Jerry Rice. I got on the cell phone. I told my wife, "Have the boys at the 50-yard line with 2 minutes to go in the game. We are crushing these dudes." It was absolutely the most magical moment that this guy instilled that kind of confidence in so many of us. And it's really my all-time favorite picture, except it looks like my boys are asleep because it's midnight here, and they're West Coasters. Another huge thing for me in life was to always continue to try to get better and to surround yourself with good people. One of the greatest linebackers to ever play the game, Junior Seau. He was a rookie in my 10th year. Yes, the jokes were all there. I was 30 years old. He was 20. He used to call me Papa Smurf, Father Time, old man. And he would disappear. This is during the season when you have meetings in the morning, and then you have a lunch break, and then you have practice. I never saw him at lunch. So I asked him one day, his nickname was Junebug. I'm like, "Junebug, where do you go at lunchtime?" He said, "I'm in the weight room." Like, "Wait, you lift weights before practice?" He's like, "Oh yeah, I go hard." I'm like, "Come on, dude, why? He said, "Because I get fatigued and I go out to practice. Now, I don't lift before a game, so when I go out for game time on game day, dude, I'm jacked and I am fresh as a daisy." Okay, I'll try it. I never missed another workout with Junior Seau at lunchtime for the rest of my career. And even when I left to go to the 49ers, a bunch of those guys up there, including JB, thought I was crazy because I would lift at lunchtime. So all of these things that Steve was talking about, you know, when he gave the introduction, I don't think there's one of these guys that played pro football in the front row over here that didn't face a ton of adversity at some point in their life. And that's what playing sports, that's what doing well in school, that's what listening to mentors, and those mentors can be so many different people. I think that's what it means, is to never, ever stop getting better. And these guys, from A Mind for All Seasons, I had a ton of issues with traumatic brain injuries. I've had over 2,500 concussions. Not many people believe that until Brett Favre last year came out and said he'd had over 2,000 concussions. And truthfully, that's probably a low estimate, because that's only talking about the times during the game. I played 250 games. There's at least 5 concussions every game that I had, sometimes 10. And oh, by the way, all those practices that you have against that 300-pound guard where you got to put your chin under his forehead, that's a concussion. You're seeing stars. Or if you're playing against the Kansas City Chiefs and the Nigerian nightmare who weighed 260 pounds, Christian Okoye, comes and you got to tackle him. So that's 2 concussions on the same play. So it's a brutal sport. And I played it until a week away from my 38th birthday. That's old. That was old to me then. Now I'm 63. Oh my gosh, I'm ancient. So what I'm saying is that for me, it was about getting better every single year. And now I've been retired. I did the broadcast for the San Francisco 49ers for 13 years after I finished playing. And it was a great opportunity, but I really couldn't do it anymore. My head, I couldn't focus. I couldn't concentrate. I was having headaches probably for about 12 years. where it felt like somebody was punching me in the back of the head 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That created depression. There were times I couldn't get out of bed for 3 days at a time. And also not being able to sleep at night. So that's what Randy was talking about when he was up here. And I owe a lot of this to the Forever Young Foundation because I found out about something that they do. It's called Sophie's Place, and it's music therapy for kids. And I started talking to some of the wounded warriors that are at some of their functions, and they said that it had helped them. So I started listening to classical music and found out that it helped. A person that has been instrumental in this, I'm going to back up just a little bit. I'm okay on time, Randy? Okay. Okay, we'll go back to that one. Perfect. But my wife is here today. Not many of us can say this, but I owe my life to my wife. Because after Junior Seau took his life, and Junior's issue were much bigger than concussions. He played 20 years, but he had a lot of financial issues, and then unfortunately, you know, was drinking too much, and she came home, and I was on my recumbent bike doing my 2 hours of cardio a day. It was 3 hours after they had done the broadcast about Junior, and I was still crying. And she said, "We're going to go get you some help." So for all you dudes out there, for all you macho guys, I talked to cops, I talked to Navy SEALs. Listen to your wife. Listen to your significant other. They see things that we don't see. Right, wives, mothers? You guys see stuff we don't see. And if it wasn't for her making me go see a counselor, who suggested I start doing yoga, it would have never happened. So I started doing yoga, and I found out that at the end of yoga, you do this thing called shavasana, where you lay flat on the ground. And trust me, guys, I did not want to do yoga. I said, "Do you have to wear a skirt to do that?" I mean, I was totally against it. So I lay down on the ground, and I start this little breathing technique. And at first, I'm mocking them. But I decided, okay, I'm here, I might as well try it. My headache went away for 30 seconds. What? I've had a headache for 12 years and it just went away. This is a coincidence. But I promised my wife I'd go back the next day. And trust me, she might be 5'2", 112 pounds. Don't mess with her. So I went back the next day. It was about 2 minutes that I felt that brief respite from the headache. Third day, it's 5 minutes. Fourth day, I signed up for an entire year. I'm like, this stuff works. So I did that, and then I put in a steam shower at home because I heard that I did hot yoga. So I did that, and I started listening to the classical music while doing my yoga in my steam shower and having the essential oils. I know this sounds really macho, doesn't it, guys? But check it out. It worked. It worked. I've since, talking with Randy and Eric from A Mind for All Seasons, you know, getting suggestions from them. If you haven't watched National Geographic, Chris Hemsworth, Limitless, it's a lot of the same stuff. And it's amazing. So I'm going to go back to the story. I was in the weight room with Junior Seau. And This was my last year in San Diego. I was 34 years old, which is old. The average age in the NFL is about 26. And yeah, JB, you used to call me out on that all the time too. So we're in the weight room in the off season working out, and here comes the general manager. And he starts negotiating my contract. I'm like, this is bizarre, but you know, we just keep lifting. You know, he's telling me what a great year I had, and you know, you were only 2 sacks behind Junior, and you had more tackles than he did. You know, we want you to come back next year, but we're going to make it a 2-year contract. We're going to give you a little bit more money next year, and then we're going to reduce it by 50% so we can amortize this. What? I had 130-pound dumbbells doing incline bench. He was about right where you were, and I literally, I'm not advising you to do this, but I literally took the dumbbells and I threw them at our general manager, and they just missed him. So that's when I had the opportunity to go up to San Francisco. San Francisco asked me if I wanted to come up there and do a little workout. And that little workout turned into a huge deal. And about an hour later, they said, Coach Seifert wants to see you in his office. He was the head coach of the San Francisco 49ers at the time. And I walked into that office, and that guy who had been the defensive coordinator for the Stanford Cardinal said, Gary, you might not be able to play in the Pac-10, but you can play for the San Francisco 49ers. 14 years later. I'm saying you don't have to say, I told you so. Let your actions speak louder than your words. And I did have a few words here, though. So, Junior will remember this. We played the Chargers 3 times the first year that I was with the 49ers. So I'd been with San Diego for 8 years. And we played them in the regular season. We played them in the preseason. This was the regular season game, of course, in the Super Bowl later. They had a 3rd and 1, and then they had a 4th and short, right about the 50-yard line. You can see all those guys walking away. They're walking back towards our bench. This guy's running in front of the Chargers bench screaming, I told you you shouldn't have let me go. I told you I wasn't getting too old. So that's where that one came from, Randy. I know you're not supposed to say I told you so, but it just happened. Randy, we can pass this off to you at any time. We're going to do Q&As. I know you've seen a few of the players up here taking pictures with the Super Bowl ring. I'll stick around as long as you need to. You guys want to wear a Super Bowl ring? Just don't try and run away with it, okay? I have 1 hit left in me, I promise. Randy Vaudry.
Sorry about the slides. All right, my friends. Listen, Gary is wonderful, and we had a little bit of challenge with our clicker for the slide. So I'm going to be giving cues to our good staff up in the booth to walk us through these slides. I'm going to show you something that Gary mentioned, and I'm going to apply it to football. So next slide. Every single one of you have had a blister on your heel, right? Everyone's had a blister? I'm assuming so. And no one worries very much about a blister. However, next slide. If you have diabetes, you have to be really thoughtful about blisters in your feet. Why is that? They don't heal as quickly. So the point to this message is that the health of the individual often predicts the outcome from an injury. So my message today is I want to make sure that everyone in this audience can take home pearls of wisdom so that when you're out there on the playing field or when you bump your head, because no one's immune, it doesn't matter if you're on the football field or if you're a cheerleader or if you're a dancer. My sweet wife has been a 20-year dancer, fantastic, danced all over the world, and she's had falls where she's hit her head. Everyone's going to have injuries like that. And we get checked out by the doctor, and sometimes we go to the emergency room, we get an MRI, we get a CT scan, and they say everything looks pretty good. But after that, sometimes things start happening. Next slide is that you've got to understand how your brain works. You have certain parts of your brain that direct your emotions and certain parts of your brain that direct your hearing, parts of your brain that affect your vision, parts of your brain that affect your motor function or your sensory function. Next slide. So one thing that most people don't understand is what percentage of your brain is neuron and what percentage of your brain is immune system cells. And this is where the football. Now, I'm no Ty Detmer and no Max Hall, but I'm going to do, I'm actually no running back either. Who can predict the answer here? And I got a football for you. What percentage of your brains are neurons? I hear 35, I hear 90. What else? You're too high. 10. Who said 10? 10. Here we go. Next slide. 10% of your brain cells are neurons. The other 90% are immune cells. What? That doesn't make any sense. That's why when you ring your bell, your immune system lights on fire, and you've got to be able to calm that down. If you don't calm that down, we start running into other challenges. Next slide. You get neuroinflammation. Well, what is neuroinflammation? People ask me all the time, what's neuroinflammation? I know what happens when my ankle swells. I know what swelling in the ankle is. What's neuroinflammation? Next slide. It's that there's brain dysfunction that occurs. Well, what type of brain dysfunction? Next slide. Let me show you some examples. Sometimes I hear athletes say, I don't feel like myself anymore. Sometimes I get really grumpy. Sometimes I'm tired. Sometimes I feel discouraged and frustrated. I don't have the energy. Next slide. Some people will say, man, I just want to tune everything out and lay in bed. Next slide. Other people will say, I can't focus anymore. I feel like I got ADD. Man, it's really interesting. When I talk to adults 40 years old, they'll say, graduated high school with honors, graduated college with honors, took the CPA test. I've been an accountant for years. Now I feel like I'm getting attention deficit disorder. What's going on? This is what's going on. There's neuroinflammation in the brain, and then one of the number one symptoms is fatigue. People just start bowing out. They don't feel like doing the things that historically they felt like doing. Let's go to the next slide. So I want to empower you with the ability to lay a solid foundation. When you walk out of here tonight, you're going to know what helps drive brain health. And these are things that your mama told you. These are things that Gary's wife, Corey, told him he should be doing when he went back to his yoga class and did Shavasana. Laid there still. Got some headache relief from it. Let's go to our next slide, okay? I mentioned this at the beginning. This is clinical pearl number two. Pay close attention to this. The health of the athlete is often more important than the nature or the force of the head injury. Gary and I have spent a lot of time talking about the definitions of concussion. Was it a grade one concussion? Was it a grade two concussion? Did you have a loss of consciousness? And oftentimes when we do those ringside assessment, those courtside, those sideline assessments, we're trying to articulate how severe of a head injury or a concussion was it. But I'm here to tell you, as important to that is what kind of health were you in at the time that you got your head struck. And Gary talked about thousands of concussions that happen in the NFL. We're often looking for the dollar bill concussion, that bell ringer that knocks your lights out. But I'm telling you that 10 dimes is worth a dollar. I'm going to say that again. 10 dimes are worth the same amount of money as $1. And if you hit your head and you feel like, oh, God, I don't really think it was a concussion. I'm okay. I can handle bright lights. I don't feel dizzy. I didn't lose consciousness. And I'll tell you, every MRI is normal. I've been doing medicine now for 20 years, and I haven't seen an abnormal MRI in a 16-year-old athlete, right? But that doesn't mean we don't pay close attention. Your health matters. Here's some of the clinical pearls. I want to tell you a quick story. Next slide. I had a soccer player from Pocatello High School. I live in Pocatello, Idaho, and I always come down for spring break because it's warm. It's not very warm this week, and I think I got hosed, right? But it's snowing at my house. In Pocatello, I had a young athlete that came into my office, and he wasn't feeling very good. He was there with his dad, and we were sorting through, why does he not feel like himself? Why is he feeling a little discouraged? What's going on? And I'm walking through all these variables to consider the health of the athlete. And then I say, well, tell me a little bit about how you eat. Dad and this young man are sitting on a couch next to each other, and this is exactly what they did. They fold their arms and they turn back to back to each other. And I thought, well, I really struck a nerve here. They're fighting about how to eat. Next slide. So the son says, Dad, you tell him. And his dad says, look, my boy eats three things. He eats mac and cheese, top ramen, and Pop-Tarts. And I said, no. I'm not talking about what did he eat today. I mean, what does he eat generally? And the kid looked at me and he says, mac and cheese, top ramen, and Pop-Tarts. And I said, every day, every single day. And my response is, oh, I'm so glad. That is such good news. And both of them just perked up and they're thinking, what are you talking about? They thought I was going to give them a hard time. And I said, this is so fixable. Like, I was worried you were going to tell me something that was tragic. Well, actually, that is kind of tragic if that's your diet. Here's how the story went on. Mom and Dad had been fighting a little bit with him. He didn't want to come home for dinner. Mom says, I'm not making two meals. If you miss dinner, you got to make your own. So he'd come home late because he didn't want to eat with his parents. And then he would make mac and cheese. Or the next day, he'd make a Pop-Tart. Or the next day, he'd make top ramen. They got into a cycle. This rhythm continued in the family until pretty soon, Mom had a whole shelf of mac and cheese, top ramen, and Pop-Tarts, every flavor that you can think of. This was his diet. Now, remember, the health of the athlete matters as much as the dime or the dollar bill that rings the bell. Does that make sense? So I said, the next slide is, I want you to eat the rainbow. And he says, okay, that makes good sense. Next slide. I eat this rainbow all the time. Do you think that's the rainbow we're talking about? Of course it's not. Next slide. It's this rainbow. Oh, we went a little too far, right? It's that rainbow right there. If you're getting your lunch and you're getting your food from the vending machines and the soda pop and all that kind of stuff, you're at higher risk. You're like the individual that has the blister that starts worrying about that thing never healing. Because what percentage of the brain is your immune system? 90%. Who said it? It's worth another football. Right here, ready? Oh, nice snag. 90% of your brain, you can't get better if you're eating this rainbow. So the next slide. This is not very sexy. When I show this, most people say, ugh, that's the reason I don't come home and have dinner with my parents. I don't want to eat that way. But there are nutrients in those foods that nourish the immune system that's in your brain. There's a researcher from UCLA named Dr. Del Bredesen. Del Bredesen has published papers on the type of dementia called atrophy dementia. And it's where the brain is starved of essential nutrients that support neurons and immune system cells and therefore support brain function. You cannot do it if you eat out of the quick stop. Okay, athletes, pay close attention. Next slide. You've got to eat brain food. What type of brain food is that up there in the middle? Oh, who said omegas? That's worth another football, baby. Who said? I heard it right here. Okay, right here. Ready? Man, I'm actually good at throwing that football. I was kind of worried that I wasn't going to get it. You might get the next one. Okay, so brain food, that omega right there. Go to the next slide. See that circle? Look, there are estimates that as much as 30% of the fat in your brain comes from omega-3 DHA. Now, I won't get too technical, but DHA is a type of omega-3, 30% of the fat in your brain. And I'm telling you, you're a fathead. Okay? Your brain is made of fat. You can't function very well. without omega-3s. You need that to protect your brain. So that's part of this discussion. Eat the rainbow. It's not just fruits and vegetables, but it's healthy meats, healthy proteins, healthy fats, omegas that make a huge difference. Next slide. How many of you work hard to protect your sleep? Oh, that dude's hand went straight up. That's worth a football. Now, I'm kind of worried. Watch your heads. Ow! You've got to protect your sleep. How many of you sleep like this? Oh, there's a hand that goes up. I'm going to give you a football only because you're emotionally committing to not sleep like that. Ready? You have a part of your brain called the pineal gland that releases a hormone. Who knows what the hormone is? Melatonin. Who said it? Who said it? You didn't say it. He knew it. He knew it. Listen, you have a part of your brain. Gary, have I missed one? Get up here, Ty. Come on. That's good. Woo! This is the only time in my life I could compete with Ty Detmer in some small way. Ty, let's see how well you do, because I'm like 7 for 7, bro. My QBR is going through the roof right now. Okay? Wait, wait, wait. Back up. Next slide. Go back to the last slide. If this is how you're sleeping, then your dime may turn into a dollar. Does that make sense? Sleep is the way that our body restores itself. We get our energy back. Our brain nourishes itself. There's a whole process called the glymphatic system that washes our brains of broken proteins. And we can't wash that brain unless we're getting good sleep. So if this is how you're sleeping late at night, your dime might turn into a dollar. You've got to be careful about that. Let's go to the next slide. Stress management. Every time I lecture or give a presentation, I gave a presentation to a continuing education group last month, and we talked about stress management. And everyone says, yeah, 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 I know I got too much stress. I got to whittle it down. And no one changes their routine. Everyone does the exact same thing that they do every day without an effort to make a difference in lowering their stress. So I want to tell you about a young high school athlete that I've worked with that actually made an effort, and it made such a significant improvement. Go to the next slide. I want to show you this young man. His name is Bentley. Bentley Whittier, what a stud, right? Next slide. Here he is with his girlfriend. Just kidding. That's his mother. Ow! She's a hottie, right? This is right before a dance. Bentley is an amazing high school athlete. Let's go to the next slide. He plays for the Northridge Knights as their point guard, shooting guard. Beginning of the season, he's averaging like 24 points a game. He's amazing. Next slide. Just like all of you, he gets dimes in those games, man. I'm at this game where he takes a massive header, drills him right in the cheekbone. He had a nice shiner for about 2 weeks. Next slide. He just stays with it. Next slide. On and on. Next slide. Okay, Bentley, legit, just like you, very good high school athlete, hustling, working hard, trying his best to be a teammate and get through the season. Okay, next slide. Bentley's team goes through a 7-game losing streak. And Bentley comes to me and he says, Randy, I don't know what's going on. I feel like I'm in the best shape of my life, and I'm completely gassed by halftime. I got nothing left in the tank. I'm exhausted all the time. I feel like I can't think straight. Things aren't very clear to me. Anything that I can do? And I started thinking, okay, what are the principles that help improve brain function, calm that immune system down? So I started walking through all this, and I realized Bentley's in a constant state. Next slide. A fight or flight. Ever heard of fight or flight? Yeah. What part of your nervous system manages the fight or flight response? Your brain. Come on, there's two parts of your nervous system. Oh, right here. Okay, Ty, let's see how well you do. Right here in the red shirt. Ow! Give it up. Your sympathetic nervous system manages your fight or flight response. So I thought, how can I help Bentley calm down his sympathetic nervous system? The first thing is you've got to recognize it. I've talked to a lot of kids when you're trying to teach them and you're trying to coach them, sometimes they're like, nah, I don't think so. That's probably not it. I don't think I'm that worried. Bentley right off the bat says, you know, I am kind of wound tight. I've been worried. We're losing our shorts right now in this season. And I said, Bentley, remember when your dad got COVID? Didn't you have a little pulse oximeter? Next slide. You guys seen those pulse oximeters? I said, let's put that pulse oximeter on your finger. He puts it on his finger and his resting heart rate is 48. And I thought, awesome, you are in fantastic shape. Bentley, I want you to slide this pulse oximeter in your pocket. And when you go to school tomorrow, I want you to pull that out, go into the bathroom, sit on the toilet instead of pulling out your phone. Pull out your pulse oximeter and check your pulse. He did that. Guess what his pulse was in the middle of the day? It's like 98, 96. This kid's in a constant state of fight or flight. That sympathetic nervous system's going crazy. So I said, okay, here's what we're going to do. Next slide. Bentley, tone down the caffeine just a little bit, right? You don't need to wake up with it in the morning. You don't need to have it at lunchtime. If you want to have a little caffeine before your game just to kind of rev you up a little bit, no problem. But I don't think we need to be doing this all day long to get that sympathetic nervous system just going crazy. Next slide. I want you to do some squared breathing. Next slide. We're going to do some squared breathing together. Here's how it works. We're going to take a deep breath. So hit it, deep breath, and we're going to take 8 seconds to do it. One, two, three. Hold it. Let it out slow. Light weights. And then hold it. Deep breath. Okay, that's called squared breathing. You can see as we go through this process right here. Next slide. I asked Bentley, go sit on the toilet, put your pulse oximeter on, and I want you to do squared breathing until your heart rate comes down to 45. Exactly what it was when you're sitting in my office. I want you to be able to take that sympathetic nervous system and calm it way down. Bentley did that. He told me the first day he took that pulse oximeter to school, he did squared breathing 6 times in the bathroom. Then he did it the next day, and then he did it the next day. And then he did it the next day. And in his next game, 26 points. They stopped their 6 or 7 game losing streak, and they won 5 of their next 6 games and qualified to compete in state. Right? Awesome. Give him a hand, right? How simple is that? That's what squared breathing does. Calms that immune system down so you can get your handle on those emotions. Next slide. There's Bentley reading the newspaper. There's him in the picture talking about one more run when they finally made it to be able to go to state. He sent me a picture of that. I thought it was awesome. Bentley's a great athlete, very coachable, very teachable. And you know what? He'll tell you, man, my energy came back. I was just so wound tight. I just couldn't slow things down. He's learned how to do that. That's going to impact him for the rest of his life. Next slide. I'm not going to take any time talking about exercise because most of y'all are athletes in here, right? You're already running, you're hustling. And it doesn't matter to me if you play football or basketball or swim or jog or play track, if you're on the dance squad, if you're a cheerleader, if you're physically active, it simply stimulates hormones in your brain that you can't get any other way. Anyone know what those hormones are? Here's one. Let's see. Endorphins. Let's give her a football. Yes, but I've got another football if you know exactly what it's called. Dopamine. That's a hormone. Not it. Serotonin. That's a hormone. Okay, let me hear right here. Hold on. Stop. It's not serotonin. It's not Ritalin. Who said that? They owe me a football. Okay, you're not going to get it. I thought maybe I had some oh, there's a hand up there. Let's hear it. Adrenaline. Yeah, it's actually called BDNF. I want you to Google it real quick on your phone. BDNF. Ty, that guy needs a football for saying adrenaline up there. Can you hit him? Ow! That was awesome. Okay, listen up. BDNF and Nerve Growth Factor, they're like Miracle Grow. You've all planted flowers in Arizona, right? You got these beautiful pots. If you plant flowers, you put Miracle Grow on it because you want those flowers to grow. BDNF is Miracle Grow for your brain, and you can't get it any other way than a little bit of physical activity. So keep it up. Next slide. Dental health affects brain health. Did you know that? If they take an individual that passes away from Alzheimer's disease and they autopsy them and they take a little slice of their brain and then they culture it in a petri dish, do you know what they'll culture out of that brain almost 100% of the time? P. gingivalis. Who said plaque? Throw him a football right here. Oh, all right, Ty, let's get Max up here. Max, you're throwing the next one. Okay, listen, almost 100% of the time, a person with Alzheimer's disease will culture out the bacteria that comes from your teeth, okay? Here's another fun story. One of my very good friends is a surgeon. He's done thousands of cortisone injections. He put a cortisone injection in one of his patient's knees, and within 3 days, it just blew up like a balloon, got infected, had to take him to surgery, open it up, drain that wound, and cultured that bacteria and thought, what is that? I do this all the time, and no one gets an infection. When he cultured that out, it was P. gingivalis, because this individual had had some dental work done 2 days before he had his cortisone injection in his knee. The bacteria that live in your mouth, it's brutal. Brush your teeth. Rinse your mouth, right? And make sure that if you have dental work that needs to be done, don't put it off. Next slide. I want to show you a quick picture. This beautiful young lady, her name is Mallory. Mallory sends me this picture and says, I keep getting this cold sore in my mouth, and I don't know why I keep getting it every couple of weeks. What do you think? Okay, if you can't see the resolution really well, but if you look above this tooth right up here, it's kind of white. We call that anemia, right? It's a little bit white, and this pocket of infection up here, this is actually an abscess tooth. That front incisor had a root canal a couple of years prior to that, and there was an infection that just kept brewing and popping out. Next slide. That abscess tooth actually chewed away all of the bone between the tooth up into the sinus cavity. There was no more jawbone left from that infection. Go figure, that's crazy. Next slide. Guess what happened to Mallory's mental health? Oh, went. Who said that? Right here, this young man needs a football. Right here, stand up so he's got a target. Ow! Nice. Would any of you have thought that your dental health directly impacts your mental health? Huge. There's a huge component of that. Pay close attention. Now, remember, I talked about in the very beginning. If you're diabetic and you get a blister on your heel, you start being really thoughtful about that. You think, okay, what can I do to heal this? I've got to be very careful. That's how I want you young athletes to be thinking about how you're eating, how you're sleeping, what's your stress level like, what's your dental health like. These things make a difference and predict whether or not that dime turns into a dollar, baby. Next slide. All right. Has anyone ever seen somebody intoxicated? Oh, they all want a football, right? Okay, tell me the symptoms. Here's an intoxication, and here's a concussion. Now, I want you to walk through the symptoms. What are the symptoms of intoxication? Okay, who said bad balance? Stand up right here. There he is. Hit him. Okay? Okay, right here in the white shirt. White shirt. Dizziness. Throw her football. What's another one? Okay. Hold on. I can only take one at a time right here. Drowsiness. Throw him a football. Slurred speech. Stand up. Here's another one right here. Wait, hold on. Right there in the white shirt. Stand up. Tiredness, fatigue. Right here. A football here and a football there. Okay, hold on. I can't see him back there. Okay, there's two kids standing up. Just throw them each a football. All right. I hope we got the liability insurance covered. Okay, listen. You get my point. If you're intoxicated, listen to that term, intoxicated. Alcohol is a neurotoxin. It does the exact same thing as a concussion. It makes you wobbly. It makes you dizzy. You can't see straight. You're sensitive to light. You have fatigue. You want to lay in bed. You can't function. You go get caffeine just so that you can work through things. That's the exact same thing a headache or a concussion does. You get a bad concussion. Your doctor tells you, go home, turn out the lights, lay in bed, don't do any major activity. You're going to get vertigo. You're going to be sensitive to light. Wear your sunglasses. Please be careful. You're too young to drink, and your parents should be thoughtful about this as well, because it's the exact same thing as a head injury. You don't want to be giving yourself a concussion every Friday night and then playing a football game, because the health of the athlete matters as much as the bell ringer. Make sense? Next slide. Okay, we're going to pound through these really quick. Hit the next slide. We focus on helping people recover from injuries, and I have just given you months worth of data and information. Next slide. That's not all you can do. Sometimes you got to dig deeper. Next slide. We can look at translational medicine. There's tons of research that talks about things that can be done, and these are the things that Gary and I have talked about, that it's not just you get an MRI and you kind of cross your fingers that you're not going to be one of the lucky ones that ends up with CTE, or you're not going to be one of the individuals that gets Alzheimer's disease. You constantly stay engaged to protect your brain, because what percentage of your brain is immune system? 3 footballs right up there at the top, baby. Next slide. One more. Here we go, one more. Very top. Yeah. Here it goes. Okay, there is so much that you can do to protect your brain, but when you leave here tonight, you now know a handful of things that will make a difference in your brain health. Next slide. So much you can do to protect your brain. Next slide. Let's see here. Let's have two people that don't have a football. So let's take this athlete right here. Hold on. And right up there in the white shirt. Okay, lights up. House lights on. I want to hear something that you're going to do different to protect your brain as a result of what you learned tonight. Wear a helmet. Thank you. Give her a... Oh, good. She almost needed that helmet for the pass. Right up here, tell me something you're going to do to protect your brain. Ow! All right. Are we out of footballs? Okay. Yeah, well done. How about a hand for our professional athletes? I know that the principles that we talked about tonight are not mind-blowing, right? I put this slide up in here to make fun of myself. These are not, oh my gosh, that was so amazing. They seem simple. They seem trite. They seem like they wouldn't make that much of a difference, but I can tell you they make a huge difference. And I want to make sure that everyone can play the sports that they love. They can do the activities that they can enjoy. That they talk about the things that Gary talked about, that you have persistence, that you don't let the naysayers get in your head. You don't quit. You align yourself with good friends. And that you do the things that will protect your brain in the long haul. Next slide. Thank you so much for your participation tonight. We're going to invite our professional athletes to come up on the stage and turn the time over to you to ask some questions, okay? And I think we got some muscles that we're going to come lift this table up on the stage. At this part of our presentation, we're going to bring these athletes up and let you ask them questions. This is always the funnest time, right? When you can say, hey, what do I got to do to get to the next step? Or I heard this, or tell me about X. We want to understand that from the athlete's perspective. Is this? Yep. We're going to leave both mics up here for him. I'm going to manage the mic. No, Ty, you have a seat. They've heard enough from me tonight. Who wants to ask some questions? All right. Stand up, and I'm going to pass the mic around.
Who was your favorite player playing in your career? Playing with in your career?
No, I thought I got a chance to play for the 49ers, and as a kid, before I made it to the NFL, I got to watch Jerry Rice play, and so he was a legend when I got there. He was kind of winding down, but kind of first time you get out on the practice field and throw him a ball, it's like, man, I threw Jerry Rice a pass, so pretty cool.
Awesome. Who else has a question? Stand up, and we'll just skip this. I'll bring this mic to you.
Who is your most feared player that you had to go against?
The most feared.
Because I'm the most scared. Goes to me. Most feared player. I would probably say toughest person I played against was Larry Allen for the Cowboys, because I think at that time he was bench pressing like. I was like close to 700 pounds. We had the same agent, though, so he was kind of nice during the game. But he was a tough guy. But there's a lot of great players. No one really truly scared of, but definitely some games you would be a little bit more concerned about who you're playing against.
How about you, Max? Who was the most feared?
The most feared? I wasn't afraid of anybody, dude, to be honest. No, I'll tell you what, the one that I have nightmares about, I don't remember his first name, but Laurinaitis, played at USC, then he was with the Rams. He's the one that hit me and dislocated my shoulder, so I still have nightmares about that one. So I'm going to go with him.
Is it hard to get in the NFL?
Bro, what? That journey was really hard. The 23 surgeries while actually there were only 17 while I was playing, and the other six have been since. So but the great thing about it is if you set a goal for yourself, I can promise you, you're not all gonna be NFL players, but you can be your best. I think that's something that's super important, is that it can't just be that I wanna be an astronaut, or I want you whatever it is that is your potential, you set a goal to reach that. I don't know what that is. You might not know what that is right now, but just continue to push yourself in whatever you're doing, and you will achieve that goal.
Which one of you guys do you think has the most concussions?
2,500. Gary, why?
Why? Because the guy I played with that I showed up here, Junior Sal, he had some great moves. He was an unbelievable athlete. So it would be like a baseball player that had a fastball, a curveball, a slider, a changeup. I had one pitch. It was a fastball. So I'd put my forehead underneath that guy's chin every time, and it didn't matter if it was Allen, who weighed 320 pounds. I'm still going to do it. And I think if there was one thing that I could change about my career, I probably would have had a changeup.
Can you remember specifically a head injury that you thought, wow, that was a big one? That's a question for each of you.
Yeah, I can think of quite a few, actually, but I would say there was a game against the Cowboys on a kickoff. I used to run down on kickoff and kickoff return and do all these kind of things, and so you go, at that time, you can go blow up a wedge. So coming down and hitting Herschel Walker at that time was probably one of the bigger collisions, and then probably back in college when I played against, I went to Notre Dame, so Jerome Bettis. So we had a practice during getting ready for the bowl game that literally, so all, we wear the gold helmet, so we had a bunch of gold flying in the air, and I had a lot of stars, so those are probably the two most significant ones that I can remember.
Mine's kind of a funny story because you can YouTube it, so go ahead and YouTube Max Hall KO and you'll see it. It's kind of funny, but I remember I was a rookie. It was my first start against the Saints, and we were down on about the 5-yard line. We call a play. I ended up scrambling out to my left, and you know how we're raised, you get to the goal line, I mean, I'm not sliding, right? So I got a couple guys coming at me, and I lower my head, and the next thing you know, I opened my eyes, and Larry Fitzgerald had picked me up, and he's shaking me. And I'm like, what happened? He's like, don't worry, man, we scored. I'm like, I got in. Well, what I didn't know is that I fumbled, and the left tackle picked it up in the end zone because I was out cold. Don't remember much, so I got made fun of in film the next day, but that was definitely the hardest hit I ever took.
So I was with the Eagles. We were playing the Cowboys on Monday Night Football. Rodney Pete had gotten hurt. I was in. Darren Woodson, a safety for the Cowboys, blitzed off the edge, and I missed it, and he put the top of his helmet right on my chin. Back then, it was legal, so I don't remember most of the second half. I finished the game, but we burned a lot of timeouts between the coach signaling in the play and me having to call it in the huddle. And so that was my only confirmed probably concussion, but they at that time nobody knew protocol or anything, and finished the game and then kind of went on from there. So.
What are some daily habits you've picked up over the years that help you be successful?
So daily habits for me is I have to work my brain on a daily basis because of all the hits and concussions, and I find if I don't, I get hazy, I forget things, I can never find my phone or where I set my keys, you know, stuff like that. So there's exercises, and breathing is a big part of it, and the meditation. And, you know, I wasn't a big meditator or yoga or anything like that. You know, when you hear that stuff, you're like, no way. But when you realize there's benefits to it, and if you do it on a consistent basis, meditation, breathing, there's even apps that work your brain and stuff that you play these games. So I have to do that on a daily basis to keep me healthy. But it's also just about having a routine and being disciplined in that routine. Because discipline creates habits, and your habits help you achieve the goals that you want. So daily disciplines is definitely what I would say helped me.
Man, I don't know. I I don't know if I have any real habits. I know I heard a speech about getting up and making your bed. My wife makes me make my side of the bed every morning. And it kind of gets you started, you know, stay organized, that kind of thing. But I don't know. I don't really have anything that I necessarily feel like I have to do every day to get going. Obviously, having a job, being here, we have first hour waits, and you're there, and you're ready to go, and you get that done, and just kind of having that daily schedule, that daily routine, like Max said, I think helps you just stay on track and be successful.
As a mother of a child that is an athlete, what do you recommend to the parents to have our kids ready before a game, or what they should do mentally before a game so that they're rested, they're ready? I mean, we know they shouldn't be on like their phone or gaming, but do you guys have anything to just have them mentally prepared? And I'd actually like to ask your wife that too. What did she do to be ready? You're going into a game. She knows you're going to get hurt. She knows you're going to get hit. What did your wives do to even be ready? Because that's a mental game, I think, for parents and for wives and your significant other. So I have a few questions. Sorry.
Just to answer that first question, I think one of the things that young athletes don't understand is that when your heart's beating faster and that adrenaline is racing through your body, you should embrace it. Don't fear it. People talk about the butterflies. Well, you know, before a Super Bowl, it's more like a condor. I mean, it is really unbelievable. But if you know what's going on physiologically, you understand that that's your body's way of focusing. So you have better eyesight when that happens. You're going to be faster. You're going to be quicker. You're going to be stronger. And you're going to be able to diagnose a play much faster. And so all of you that play sports, or it can even be going into a test, you have to go in there with confidence. But understand, those nerves that you're having, that doesn't mean that you're not ready. It actually means you are ready. And I think it's really important for you guys to know that.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't married when I was playing, so I didn't have anybody to tell me to kind of get tuned in. But I think for me, it was just about kind of just being in the moment and embracing what it was. And I used to tell myself every time I went out in the field, you know, play like it's your last game, until one day in 2000 it was, in the third game of the season, and went out and got injured and never played another down. So up until that point, I'd never missed a game. So I think just being present, enjoying the moment, like Gary said, embracing all that comes with it, anxiety, excitement, the fear, the uncertainty. And I think today it's as parents and as spouses and as athletes, you're more aware about being mindful. So I think there's a lot of things that you can use from a technology standpoint, like apps, like waking up. Is something that I've embraced over the last year. I had a good friend of mine introduce me to it. So it's kind of like a calm, but it's a different approach. And so download it. It's on the, it's got a 30-day free trial. So just download it and just try it out. But it's a different way of kind of approaching mindfulness and how to think about it. And I think if I had it, you know, 20-some years ago when I was still playing, it'd been fantastic.
Could each of you share one of your most cherished memories from the NFL, something that you'll never forget because it was life-changing and so beneficial for you?
I didn't play as long as these guys up here. I was, the NFL not for long thing definitely got me with injuries and stuff. So, but I did get 2 years. But one of my favorite memories in the NFL is I got to throw a touchdown pass to Larry Fitzgerald. And I remember after the play, he came running over to me. He handed me the ball, you know, told me great job. And to have an NFL legend hand you a ball and tell you great job and have that experience with him. So I didn't win a Super Bowl, you know what I mean? I didn't do anything big, but I got close with Larry, and his friendship meant a lot. So being able to throw him a touchdown pass was, you know, in my opinion, pretty cool.
I think for me, the opportunity for a first start, because I was kind of like Gary, too small, too slow, not a strong enough arm. And then to kind of put 4 years in behind Brett Favre, and then having a chance to go to Philadelphia and getting a first start was pretty special. My parents were able to be there. My dad was a high school football coach for over 50 years, so football was a big part of our life, and having them there and that opportunity to get a chance to be a starter in the NFL was pretty special for me.
I was an undrafted free agent coming out of college, so I spent my first 2 years on the practice squad, so basically means you do everything but get to play in the game, and I think just the opportunity just to kind of be there and make it that first year was memorable, and obviously first starts and playing that first experience, but the year we won the Super Bowl was my second year on the practice squad, so while I didn't get to play in the game, getting that ring and being part of that, I felt like it was an incredible memory.
So it was during training camp, remember how fun those are. The coaches on offense asked me if I would be a backup goal line and short yardage fullback because they didn't have one. And as these guys as coaches know, they know what's going on with the entire team. They know what they need. And my first response was, are you kidding me? There's no way. I'm already too beat up. But, you know, the coach was a great guy, and he took his time after practice and taught me all the routes and taught me who I was supposed to block on every play. And I didn't really think anything of it. I think I had to go in once a week for team meetings on the offensive side of the ball, even though I played defense. And we're in Pittsburgh. I just got finished having 6 stitches put in my the brow of my forehead on the sideline. And all of a sudden, they start screaming for me to get in the game. And I'm like, get in the game. It's offenses out there. I know, our fullback is hurt. So I go to the coach. He tells me, roll pass right, Z7 sneak on 2. And I'm running out there, and I'm literally almost at the huddle. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's me. So roll pass right, I have to fake a kick out block. And then just continue into the corner of the end zone. And Ty, I'm telling you, that ball was in the air for about 4.5 minutes. It was spinning so slow. And fortunately, I caught it. But that was it. I scored a touchdown in the NFL because I was a backup. No, I did not want to play offense full time after that. No. I liked hitting quarterbacks.
What was the toughest team each of you played first?
Well, I guess because we kept on losing to them in the playoffs was the Packers, unfortunately.
Mm. Yeah. They were all tough. I mean, every team we faced, I thought we were going to win, but I knew it was going to be a battle. But those Dallas Cowboy teams in the 90s were absolutely incredible, and it was nice knocking them off.
I think the toughest team I played was actually Seattle. This is when Hasselbeck was still there, and they had a really good team. And I remember we get up there, and I'm starting. And it's raining, it's cold, and in the first series, I took 2 hits, and it was one of those things like, man, do I want to finish this game right now? But, you know, I sucked it up and finished it. But I just remember taking a lot of hits in that game, and it being rainy and cold, and that was not a good day for me. Not a good day.
We played Baltimore when they won the Super Bowl that year, and they had a really good defense. I think their defense basically won them the Super Bowl. So as an offensive player, Ray Lewis, those guys were flying around, and a really good defense at that time.
Do you guys think the reduced physicality in practices, like in preseason, a lot of players sit out the preseason and stuff, is that a good thing, you think, or is that sort of hurt him in the end?
Yeah, I actually think, and I've had conversations with some teammates, former teammates, I think there's a good and bad, and I think there's a negative aspect of, Gary talked about like the training camps we used to do in Rockland, 100 degrees, you know, doing practices, padded practices twice a day. Yeah, maybe that could be too much if you do that for 2-3 weeks in a row. But when you're only going to practice on a padded practice maybe once a week or whatever they do now, I think there's extremes, right? And so you've now have gone, the pendulum has swung too far the other way, and you see it in the number of guys who are on the injured reserve list by the end of the year. So there's a certain bit of conditionality you have to have. You've got to kind of get hit. You got to be hit. You got to hit people. It's like I always talk about TIE fighters. Like they deaden the nerves on their shins by rolling logs on their shins, because it's not like all of a sudden after 2 weeks of two-a-days, like we're not sore anymore. It's like you're conditioned to being hit. So that's my personal take. I just think, you know, you got to find a right balance, and they're trying to do something.
All right. Thinking back to high school, college, and even some degree your pro career, with all the demands placed on you as student athletes and athletes, you know, things like class, practice, homework, media obligations, life, etc., what strategies did you use to cope with all of that stress? Deep.
Okay, so basically kind of what you're saying is with everything going on with school and family and everything, how do we stay focused playing? I think a big part of it is being able to compartmentalize the different parts of your life. When you're at home, you're with your family. You're not thinking about other things. When you're in class, you're thinking about class. And then when you're at football, you do that. And I think if you do that, you can give more energy and effort to each area of your life, right? So you handle each area different. Some areas are more intense. Some, you know, when I'm at home, I need to be calm. I can't let, you know, having a bad practice, I can't bring that home to my wife and kids. I got to be loving and understanding towards them. So for me, I just had to keep them separate. And if I kept them separate, then I seemed to be able to excel better in each area of my life. So,
Junior, how about you? How did you manage the mental health component during the tough years of football?
I don't know. I think going back then, I'm in college. I mean, I went to Notre Dame, so we just had certain expectations, and you just had to do certain. You had certain roles you had to fill. You were expected to go to school. You expected to perform well in the classroom. If you didn't, you couldn't play. So it was just more about these are the standards, you got to live up to it. And like Gary talked about when he spoke earlier tonight, you know, everybody deals with adversity, and you've had adversity in your life. And when I was young, I got burned when I was 15, and that had a huge impact on my life and how I view things. And so, like Max said, I can put things in a kind of a box and deal with it as they came. And I think that experience had a profound impact on my life and how I approached anything I did.
Awesome. Thank you. Do we have one more questions for our athletes today? Go ahead and stand up. Rattle off your question while I get over there.
Listen, I'm already thinking about week three, okay? It's already in my head. Do we judge it off of passing yards? Do we judge it off of touchdowns? Or do we judge it off of wins?
Ty would say you judge it off looks.
All right, so I got a funny story, okay? So I always joke with Ty that I was better. You know, I'm like, you know, I won more games than you, so I'm better. But obviously we have a Heisman Trophy. He leads BYU in yards and touchdowns. He had a phenomenal career. 16 years in the NFL? 14 years in the NFL. And I remember I was messing around. I had a fake Heisman Trophy that I was giving somebody, and I put it up in my office, and I'm kind of joking around to the students that it was mine, you know, that I won a Heisman Trophy. So Ty gets wind of it. One day he walks into my office, and he hands me a plaque. And the plaque says, Max Hall, second team All-Mountain West. It was an old plaque that I didn't want, and I gave it to a BYU donor, and somehow it ended up in Ty's backpack. So Touche, brother. Touche, man. Well played. Well played, Ty.
All right. Listen, how about a big hand for all of these professional athletes and their wisdom? We're going to go ahead and wrap this up tonight, but we want to invite all of you if you want some autographs. I think all of you have footballs. They should have already been signed, but if you want to come up and ask some individual questions, the athletes will linger longer for maybe 10 minutes longer. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Appreciate you.
All right. Great job, everybody.